So first of all, I would like to say thank you to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to be here in this nice summer school, Nicolás Cabrera. I will talk about the experimental side of Luis talk about the graphene plasmid and so on. I would like to go to the experimental side, how we visualize these plasmids, not only graphene but in other 2D materials. In principle, we don't want only to visualize these graphene plasmids. This I tell you in advance that these are graphene plasmids. But we also would like to control their propagation, to make some application. So there we face several problems that they will discuss next. We also work with other materials. This is another material different than graphene. This is graphene, but this is hexagonal boron nitride, and this is another material, which is a metal oxide that we recently have studied. These are all 2D materials, or not 2D, but van der Waals materials. So the ones that Luis was discussing, that they have a very weak forces in the vertical direction, and then you can exfoliate just with a tape. You can just take planes of them. And one plane is different than two planes in the physics. And this is the cool thing about this material. So, and this has opened a complete field, right? And some people, a friend of mine, I think it's the same friend that Luis says that goes to the museum, says that these van der Waals materials have democratized science, material science, because with very cheap materials and with a tape, you can get really, really good samples to study nice physics. Before, it was funny because I did my PhD with MBE. This is the technique that Luis was saying, that you have to study a lot of surface physics to learn how to grow good samples, semiconductor samples. There was a whole four or five years worth of how to learn how to make these materials, and now I can take a piece of material, take my tape, it's a handicraft, and then I take this and I get a better material. So it's really curious, this evolution of material science during the last years. I would like to come back to very simple notions like graphene plasmids. Probably along this week you have seen this many times, but I would like to emphasize the importance of surface plasmids. So the diffraction limit of light imposes that a spatial resolution cannot be larger than the wavelength of light in the free space divided by two. So you take a microscope, an optical microscope, and you can see something that is smaller than 300 nanometers. So this means that nanoscience or the nanotechnology power cannot be used in optics, because optics is just limited by this fundamental limitation, and which comes from the uncertainty principle, actually. So, but there are ways to overcome them. And one of them is the excitation of surface plasmids. What are surface plasmids? Well, I think it's not needed, but let me emphasize the conditions of existence and their properties. They exist in between some material that has an epsilon, negative epsilon, could be a conductor, but I will show you that also polar materials, as Luis said, also have an epsilon, a negative epsilon, and some spectral bands, and air, for example, a dielectric. And they are a surface wave that involve mass, right, in the metal, electrons. So the momentum is larger. They have to move something that is heavy. And they are a solution of Maxwell equations. It's very simple, classical physics. The most important property is this one, is that the dispersion of these surface waves lies below the light line. So this means that at a certain frequency, the K of this surface wave is much larger than the one from the light, the light in the vacuum. So this means that the wavelength is much shorter. So we can squeeze. It's a funnel for light, right, in the material. And this means that these are the properties, right, that the plasma wavelength is much smaller than the incident wavelength. And you can also enhance, because they are evanescence waves, they are in the surface, that you can enhance the field intensity. So this, during years working on metals, mainly in gold and silver, has triggered a lot of applications, and one of the most important was single molecule Raman spectroscopy this SERS mechanism that Ruben was discussing 2 days ago. So, but let me say that there are problems with metals. So they have strong optical losses because of this electron-electron scattering is dominating. There is a lack of electrical control. You cannot put there a voltage and control the properties of this surface wave. It's very difficult or impossible. And it's difficult to control the metal surface geometry by nanolithographic techniques and so on. So here is where the democracy of material science appeared not very long ago by Novoselov and Gein and others. And you can see that many different materials that are exfoliated by these techniques, very simple techniques, can show polaritons of different nature. And this is what Luis was saying. You can have plasmon polaritons in other materials like graphene or black phosphorus. Black phosphorus is anisotropic, which is very interesting in the plane. And then you can have phonon polaritons. This is what I talk to you later. I told you that the conditions for existence of surface plasma is that the dielectric constant is negative. In polar materials are like metals, but in the infrared. So they have the dielectric constant negative in the infrared, 10 microns or so. Actually, we saw yesterday the nice talk about thermal control of light radiation. And it was, one of the materials was silicon carbide was used. And the other day was also by Carlos, another talk about radiation, thermal radiation. And all these materials are polar materials, silicon carbide, for example. And now, silicon carbide was one of the materials that supported phonon polaritons historically. But it's a very difficult material for engineering. It's a very hard material. So now it appears, for example, here, hexagonal boron nitride, which is a van der Waals material. You can exfoliate very easily. And you can engineer easily as well. So it opened. It came to us to help us to develop new applications, right? And then exciton polaritons with semiconductors, transition metal decalcogenides like diesel molybdenum disulfide, tungsten diselenide, and others. And then Cooper pair polaritons or magnum polaritons that are less studied for the moment. Magnum polaritons may be a bit more than copper pair polaritons, but this is for some people. These are the holy grail in the next years, because they can explain superconductivity, high temperature, and so on. Okay. So this is the outline of the talk. I will try to explain to you how we were able to visualize graphene plasmons. Then we did the work on how to measure them, how to probe them electrically, not only optically. And finally, talk a little bit about phonon polaritons, right? These similar counterparts, but in different with different properties. Like they have less losses because they involve the lattice, not the electrons, like the plasmons. Okay, and the lattice has phonons, for example. You know very well, you study in solid state physics, that they live longer than because the losses by phonon scattering is lower than the electron scattering. So let's start with graphene plasma polaritons. Luis has already introduced it very well. The main property I want to highlight here is that they were predicted, of course. And the main property here is what he said, that they are really confined. This is the light line, and this is the dispersion curve. And that here, it appears the fine structure constant, which is 1 divided by 137, which explains that they are really, really confined. And then here, this Fermi energy. So it's a material that you can make a field effect transistor. You can make a field gating, I mean, with a metal below some dielectric. You can make capacitive coupling, and then you can change the Fermi energy of the material. And this, just with a knob, you can make it very metallic or an insulator. This is the key property of graphene. Okay? So if you are able to do this, these are the bias that you can apply. If you are able to make such a sample, where at some points you can make it graphene metallic and some others are insulator, you can define, for example, a waveguide or an interferometer just electrically. You just put a voltage, you create here graphene that is metallic and the other is insulator. So then, without any physical boundary, you can create a waveguide. This is really cool, right? For the moment, I think nobody has realized it because there are other problems, but I think it's an engineering problem and it will be solved. So, but what happens if they are really confined? Is that the momentum is very large. The graphene plasmid momentum is very large. This means that the momentum mismatch with light in vacuum is so large that you can excite them easily from far field. So, and this was the problem. How can we visualize them? And then there appeared two papers at the same time, theoretical papers, one from Luis group and the other from Javier García Bajo and Frank Coppens, where they proposed that if you put a dipole in close proximity to the graphene, the dipole has enough momentum to excite these waves. So we just see these papers and then we realize that our system, our experimental system, could be the right tool. What is our experimental system? It's a scattering near field optical microscope. It's basically an AFM that you illuminate with light. And because the tip is metallic, you can create a small dipole in it. So it's just a large amount of mirrors with lasers that you use to guide light to that such kind of cone. You put some polarization like this, and then you have here electric dipole, okay? This is very easy. In the end, you have here a tiny spot of field. And if you make a calculation, it can be like this. So you have a lot of field on the tip apex. And what happens if you have a lot of electromagnetic field localized and spatially in a small region? Imagine if you make the Fourier transform. You can get a really broad family of K's, a broad range of K's that you can use, right? Something that is very localized in space, transform, it's really decolized in K space. So we have available K's, really large available K's to launch. So, and this was the easiest experiment I think I ever done, and probably the most productive scientifically. And it was just putting the graphene below the tip, and suddenly we saw these fringes. Well, we had to have a good graphene. It was a graphene on silicon carbide in this case, which had high mobility. And then we saw these fringes, and we said, okay, they have to be surface plasma. But we need to interpret our signals, because we saw kind of interferometric signals. I mean, I told you that the surface plasmas are surface waves, and they are evanescent, so they decay exponentially. But here we see fringes. So it looks like it's an interferometric detection. And then we tried to interpret it, and we interpret it the following way. Our SNOM, our tip, is working as an echo detector. So it is launching the wave propagates. It has to meet some boundary or defect or whatever that reflects back, like an echo detection. And then it comes back, and then it interferes with the one that is already going on there. So it makes an interferogram. And part of it that comes back hits the tip and then scatters to the detector in the far field. So we are looking at the interferometric signals. And as you know, when you have an interferogram, the distance between two fringes is lambda of the wave divided by two. OK, we understood it, and we took the images. It was, I think I should put here another reference, because there were two papers at the same time, in the group of Dmitry Basov in the States. And what we also did is that using this key property of graphene, you put some voltage, and then you can switch off the graphene plasmas or change their properties. I didn't show them, but here you can see how the fringe spacing is changing and so on. So it's really cool that we can visualize them. They were demonstrated before. They were measured in the far field and in cavities of graphene, but not visualized. And I think visualization of these kind of things is very important. Later on, we did another work. We did cavities instead of these large flakes. We did cavities to study the modes inside this cavity. And we realized that you can have very different patterns. And actually, you can have sheet modes that propagate more or less in the plane I mean, in the bulk, let's say bulk, but it's not bulk because it's one monolayer. But in the entire geometry of the cavity, and some others that are only at the edge. So we have edge and seed modes, and they interfere and give the strange patterns that we were able to determine and study. And another work, we were working with graphene on silicon carbide. The mobility was high, but not high enough to study really the properties of decay of these materials and so on, of this graphene plasma and so on. So thanks to a collaboration with a group of James Holm at Columbia University, we got really nice samples where graphene is encapsulated in hexagonal boron nitride. When you encapsulate graphene on this other material, it happens like magic, and then all the dirty is like a spell out of the graphene to the outer parts of the flake, and then you can get mobilities as large as 100,000, which is amazing at room temperature. So it's really the perfect 2D gas that I was in my PhD trying to fabricate during years and years. Here you just put this handigraph. Okay, this is only this group, and all other two groups can make these nice samples, okay? Because there are a lot of tricks and so on. But it's amazing how by taking one layer here and encapsulating with another two and so on, you can get this quality, right, for studying physics. Okay, and then we did the same experiment and we saw a lot of fringes. And then we could study how the decay of these fringes is, and we saw that the lifetime of this graphene plasma is 500 femtoseconds. It could sound a small number, but if you take into account that the plasmons in metals are in the range of 30 femtoseconds, you can see that they are much longer life. Okay, and then they have the tunability. So they are cool, and applications are appearing more and more. But as I told you, I have my echo detector, this tip. But I would like to see how these surface plasmons evolve in space. I would like to shape the wavefronts. I would like to do some application to control light at the nanoscale. And with this technique, it's not possible. So years before on these experiments, we were working on the same technique, but using silicon tips instead of metal tips. We were using silicon tips to map the electric fields around Gall antennas, because we wanted to visualize the fields that are excited in the dipole antenna that are used, for example, for sensing or another applications. And actually, we did the cross polarization scheme. So this is how it is called. And this paper is from Ruben. I think it was the first paper that used this technique. We were actually very successful, and we could map very nicely the fields that are excited in such a rod. You can see here how the fields are enhanced at the extremities, where the plus and minus is on the dipolar mode, and how we could also map the phase. In this case, we were mapping the X components in the plane, so you can see the plus and minus, red and blue, but only the same phase. Because here, in the X component, which is in this direction, here the fields enter, and here they go out on the same with the same phase. Okay, if I will be mapping the Z component, it will be opposite. So we were able to use a silicon tip to map fields. So why don't we use a silicon tip to map the graphene plasmas? Okay, I have to tell you that this here, one order of magnitude of signal is lost, because the scattering efficiency of a silicon tip is much, much lower than a metal tip. So, okay, it was a difficulty, an experimental difficulty, but we wanted to try. So the scheme of the experiment was the following one. We had the graphene, we need to excite the graphene plasmons. Now we don't have the tip. So let's put the tip on the sample. So we built a Gall antenna on top of the surface to use its localized fields to launch the graphene plasmons, to beat this mismatch of momentum. Okay? The role that the tip was doing before, now is this antenna here. And now we just come with our tool and we bring our silicon tip to just try to map these fields that are coming out of the antenna. Well, these were the measurements and the calculations. We did this Gall antenna that is resonant at the wavelength that we were measuring. We are measuring in infrared, 11 microns, 10 microns. This is the range where graphene plasmas exist for the moment. And here we put the non-resonant one to see that this, the non-resonant one is not launching. The resonant one is launching. And then you see these waves emanating from the antenna. So we put the tip, and then we could recover this image, and then you can see that it reflects kind of the calculation. So we can see the graphene plasmons with the directed tip. And more importantly, we are not here doing interferometric measurement. Here we are mapping just what is propagating out of the antenna. And because we are doing this, we can shape the antenna to shape the wavefront. And therefore, we do here a gold rod with a convex extremity or a concave extremity. And then the wavefronts that are emanating from this antenna, they follow the contour of the antenna. So they can have a converging nature or a divergent nature. And this is what we map here. Here, this is the experiment, and this is the calculation. So you can see that the wavefronts are diverging in space, and here you can see that we can focus them because they are converging by making this parabolic shape on the antenna. Why is this happening? And this is, I think, this is unique of graphene. This is happening because Huygens principle is almost not playing a role, or is it playing a minor role in this system, because the antenna size is much, much larger than the graphene plasma wavelength. So if there is interference between some waves that are emanated here and this point next to it, it's very localized. Happening very localized. It's not happening like in a normal antenna we have in our roofs, where you have always interference and then you have these lobes of radiation. Here it follows exactly the contour of the antenna. So if you shape the antenna, you shape the wavefronts that are emanating from the antenna. This is the only system. And this is only because the graphene plasmons are so short compared to the size of the antenna. So there is such a mismatch that you can avoid this interferometric stuff from Huygens' principle. Okay, so we were able to focus light at the spot here, and then well, here we did some profiles and so on. And well, this is a device, right? A proof of concept device. We have a lens for graphene plasmas. We have a lens for nano optics for beating this diffraction limit. We are using 10 microns wavelength, and we are having spots of 200 nanometers. If I translate this to the visible, I could have light. Or in the green, 500 nanometers, and I can have spots of below 10 nanometers. So that would be really amazing. For the moment, it's not realizing the visible, because we cannot dope graphene so much to have graphene plasmas in the visible for the moment. Normally, when you try to dope, the dielectric breaks down. Okay, so we have the lens, but we can also do other things. And in this case, what we did is we put the gold antenna, and next to it, we tried we found a bilayer of graphene. And by taking one with this shape, we can make some kind of a prism. Why? Because the bilayer graphene has another conductivity, optical conductivity. And therefore, it is higher. Actually, it goes with the square root of the number of layers. If we have two, we have a square root of two, 1.4, the conductivity of one monolayer. So it's another medium. It's like, I would say, air, water. Okay, two different media with two different refractive indexes. So we said, okay, let's try to launch here plasmons and see what happens when they come out to the other media. Can we see refraction of plasmons? Is this a prism? And then we found, this is the you can see here there are a lot of dirty and so on, because these are all lithographic processes. I don't know if you know, but here we use a lot of chemical stuff, resist and so on. Difficult to remove everything, because graphene is one layer, okay, of material. But still, it works. This is also, for me, it's very, very surprising, because with 3-5 semiconductors, when I was working in the PhD, you had to be so, so careful with the cleanness of the surface and so on. In graphene, even with very dirty surface, you can see optical effects, really nice optical effects. And then we saw this thing here. Okay, we visualized with a silicon tip, right? Because with a metal tip, we will have this all the launching, and then it will be impossible. And then if we study it carefully, we see that this wave that goes here comes out with this angle. If you study a little bit the angles and so on, you can see that more or less, this is the Snell's law, more or less, this difference in refractive index follow the angles that are the sinus of the angles that are measured. So we can say that qualitatively, we have made a prism that follows the Snell's law. I would say that this is the thinnest and the smallest prism ever demonstrated. I don't know if it's useful. It's not useful for anything for the moment. But My dream and the dream of some people, I guess, is that this prison will be active. If I can make below a gate that can dope as you wish this piece of bilayer, you could change this angle with a knob. And then you can make a router. And this router of light is something happening at really, really sub-diffraction scales. It's really nano-optics. But for the moment, technologically, we are not able to do it. Let's see if in a few years we can. So I then enter in the next topic. It's the electrical detection of graphene plasmas. Everything I have told you until now, it was optical detection with this AFMT. Okay? But why, for devices and so on, it will be interesting to have some electrical detection. So what we did is to design also a device made also in the group of the HOME in Columbia University, where they encapsulate graphene in boron nitride to have high mobility. And then they put two contacts here to measure current. What current? Current that is producing graphene because of thermoelectric effects. Why thermoelectric effects? Because it's a really strong process in graphene. So what is the idea? The idea is to create a PN junction in graphene. Therefore, we have here two local gates to dope above the graphene. Here we can dope N, and here we can dope P. Then we have a PN junction. And by having a PN junction, you can have a control of the Seebeck coefficient that enters into this equation of the thermoelectric photocurrent. And then you need this change of variation of temperature, a spatial variation of temperature, to have a photocurrent. And there, that we can provide with the tip. The tip can go there and provide a hot spot that can create this variation of temperature. So therefore, if we have this temperature, we have, well, this variation of temperature, we have electromagnetic force, and finally we can have a photocurrent in the middle. Okay, we can have a very good detector of heat with graphene. Can we use it to map graphene plasmons? Because graphene plasmons, in the end, they decay into heat. So if we are mapping with the tip, we can see how these plasmons decay into heat and probably resolve them spatially. This is what we saw. These are made at terahertz frequencies, okay? 100 microns wavelength. And then we saw this. Look at the scale here, 1 micron. We are really in the sub-diffraction limit. So, and then we saw these fringes. And they, of course, resemble those that I showed you before. And I said, okay, these are graphene plasmons in the terahertz regime. But they are measured. This is not an optical image. This is an electrical image. This is the current here. When I have the tip here, I see this current. When I have the tip here, I see this current and so on. And this is because the tip is launching the plasmons. The plasmons make this interference and then they decay into heat that provokes a current at that point. Okay, so this is 118 microns, resolution of 50 nanometers. This is a really cool detector for plasmons, actually. And then we were mapping at different wavelengths. Because if you want to demonstrate that they are graphene plasmons, you should track the dispersion of them. So we measured different wavelengths, and then we had this dispersion, and actually we were partial with this dispersion curve because it's linear. You saw before in Luis' talks that normally the dispersion, it's parabolic, right? It's not linear. So it's kind of acoustic regime, it's acoustic nature, like sound waves, right, that are linear. I think we were partial because we were ignorant of this effect, but now I will tell you why. But it is nice to compare to this dispersion with the dispersion that you can find in graphene that is just with air above and below, which is here. And then you can see that it's really, really linearized, but also it's much, much shorter, the plasma wave than it's expected because of this device, this way of making the sample. Why so? Well, here, this is the graphene that is in air. You can see here the numbers. This is 10 microns, this is 30 microns. Remember that we are illuminating with 100 microns. So, okay, they are plasmas, but they are confined, but it's not so confined as we are seeing here. Okay, what do we have? We have a gold mirror below the graphene. We had, remember, we had In the system, we have boron nitride, graphene, boron nitride to have a very high quality graphene. And then we have these local gates below. And these local gates are acting as a mirror. And actually what they are doing is just like reflecting all the fields that are here below to the boron nitride that is in between. And they are, in the end, is a coupled mode with the graphene. It's an optical coupled mode. And it allows you to see that you can squeeze all the field in this region, which makes an enormous vertical confinement of this with this value. This has been recently exploited by Köppen's group by using a monolayer instead of this. This was like 20 nanometers, 30 nanometers was squeezed on that. Now they use a monolayer of material, and then they have to claim that it's ultra, I don't know, atomic confinement of graphene plasmas and so on. And then non-local effects that were discussed in many talks during this week appear, and it's really nice to see how physics have to be revisited to understand what happens there. Okay, so I enter now, I don't know how much time, 5 minutes, okay. In the last 5 minutes I want to talk to you about phonon polaritons. I told you that there are other materials that behave like metals, but in the infrared. Okay. Why is this so? Because, I mean, the same physics, the same Maxwell equations say that if you have a dielectric constant negative, you can have surface waves. So if you take the dielectric constant of polar materials, you can see that in the so-called restraling band between TO and LO, between the optical phonons, they have a negative dielectric constant. So there, they should support polaritons, and these are called phonon polaritons. But in nature, they are very different. One is the movement of electrons, that is a screen, the field that is incoming. In the other case is the vibration of the atoms that tries to screen the incident field. So it are the atoms that are moving and the localized electrons that are close to the atoms, which makes the dipole that tries to screen the incident field. Right? So, I mean, the negative dielectric constant means that the metal or the material tries to screen what is incoming, right? The electric field that is incoming. So in this case, it's the lattice vibrations that are trying to screen it. Okay, if you compare at the same wavelength, for example, a gold antenna and a hexagonal boron nitride antenna that supports phonon polaritons, you can see that the quality factors are completely different. If you have a phonon polaritonic antenna, you can have really, really high quality factors. Why? Because phonon polaritons, they don't decay as fast as plasma polaritons. Because as the lattice vibration, the roots or the ways to lose the energy is promoting another phonon, and this is much less efficient than the electron-electron scattering in metals. Okay? So, okay, it looks like it's really good antenna to do, for example, sensing, strong coupling phenomena, and so on, but it's in the infrared. Okay, remember, it's in the infrared. And the community has always worked in the visible. I mean, it's normal because the technology is all made in the visible, CCDs and so on. But lately, during the last years, I mean, in the infrared, there have been appearing more systems and systems, experimental systems that are improving the sensitivity and so on. So I think there's a niche for good studies on nano-optics. Okay, so actually discussing with, I was as a postdoc doing all these works in the group of Rainer Hillenbrand, the nano-optics group at Thignan Uguni, and discussing with him, he was always saying, I was too early working with phonon polaritons, because actually he published in 2002 on silicon carbide the visualization of phonon polaritons. So, and at that time, I think he got like, I don't know, 10 citations in his paper or so during many years. And now, with the hexagonal boron nitride and so on, it's exploding. Now it's really getting important. So this is a hexagonal boron nitride. This is how they look normally when you exfoliate. This is a flake. Why is hexagonal boron nitride is also interesting? Okay, it's interesting because it has also an anisotropic behavior, optical behavior. It is hyperbolic material. What does it mean? The dielectric function is different along different directions of the material. This is the important thing the message I want to tell you in this material. So, in the end, it happens that the isofrequency surface of a hexagonal boron nitride momentum space is a hyperboloid. What does it mean? Remember the isofrequency curve. This describes how light can propagate in a material. If it's an isotropic material, you can describe it with a circle or a sphere in 3D where any k can propagate in the material with the same, in any direction you have the same vector, okay, with the same properties, wavelength and so on. And the pointing vector, which is the energy, it's perpendicular to this isofrequency curve, so they are parallel. in, this is a normal behavior in isotropic materials. But what happens in this material is it's a hyperbola. And because it's a hyperbola, you don't have any k supported, and also you have an asymptote where many k's can go. If many k's go there, is that you can have many, many waves along one direction of the material. If you have many, many waves with different k's along one material, you create a ray. And this ray has its energy perpendicular to the k vector. This is not very intuitive from the first sight. I mean, you need to think a little bit. In reality, the ray goes in one direction, and the k, which means the direction of different planes or different phase of the wave, go in the perpendicular direction. So then it goes like this, but imagine that the phase blue and red is not doing blue, red, blue, red, blue, red, blue, red in the direction of the energy. It goes in the opposite direction. So the red has only one color, red, because the k goes in the other one. It's really peculiar. It's really peculiar. It's an exotic effect. So this is the ray in the simulations. You can see it goes in one direction, which is the asymptote of the hyperbola, the hyperbola. And then if you make a slab instead of an infinite layer, you have to make a flake, you can see these triangular shapes that propagate there the light. It's quite nice to see these rays. And actually, you can study them with different modes, slab modes. It was visualized for the first time by the Bassers group in this paper. And then we also work in different other papers to measure the edge modes and so on. They are really nice. So later on, we move to nanoantennas. Let's take this material that supports this phonon polar dance. Let's make antennas lithographically. I told you that engineering of this material is easier than is on silicon carbide. So we were able to map the modes, dipolar modes, and so on in these phononic materials. The quality factor are very high, much, much higher than you can find in a metallic antenna. So quality factor 100 is really already high to see strong coupling effects. This is an image of some antennas we were measuring. And then we put some molecules on top and so strong coupling in this regime. This is kind of recent work. And I don't have time to show you, but lately we were working on another material, this molybdenum trioxide. And this is really peculiar because it's an anisotropic, not out of plane. The previous one, I showed you that the rays are traveling in the set direction like this, but in plane. So you can see here that we have waves only in one direction, not in the other. So this is the first material on this collection of 2000 that we can study that has an anisotropic in-plane phonon polarity. It's really, really interesting because actually you can get study nanostructures. You can see how the waves reflect on different directions. And if you take the Fourier transform, you can recover that they can be hyperbolic in the plane. So I think it's a very, very nice material. Okay, this is the group that we work together in at the University of Oviedo. We are kind of a recent group. We are working on nano-optics, on 2D materials. We have all capabilities. So if you are interested in some of these topics and so on, you can contact me. And we have open positions also for postdocs and students. So, and of course, acknowledgments to all the people, many people involved in all these works. And I have to always say it, thank you for the money, the ERC starting grant, and also to the Prize from Spain. And thank you all for your attention.